Good afternoon, everyone. I welcome you all on behalf of the Department of Medical Oncology to today's clinical combined round. Today's case basically pertains to a young male who recently visited us in the clinic on a long-term follow-up visit. Heads up to you that this is not a rarest of the rare case or an unusual presentation or any twisted turn in the treatment. It is rather a straightforward clinical presentation of a rare disease, which everyone must be aware of, especially those who are working in medicine and emergency rooms. And this was the main theme of our presentation today. With this background, I now request Dr. Rohit to present the case, and Dr. Aparna would take us through the review of literature. Dr. Rohit.
Thank you, sir, for the kind introduction. So without further delay, I will start the case. So this is about a 25-year-old male who is a resident of Delhi, India. He is an engineer. He presented to us in January 2017 with complaints of cough and occasional hemoptysis for the past 6 months. Regarding the history of presenting illness, the cough was insidious in onset, gradually increasing in severity. There was no associated expectoration, no specific aggravating or relieving factors, and there was no history of any diurnal or postural variation in the nature of cough. The hemoptysis was insidious in onset, bright red in color, occasional, and it was tricky, meaning that it was a mild occasional hemoptysis. There was the negative history. What we had noted was that there was no history of any dyspnea, orthopnea, chest pain, fever, fatigue, weight loss, drenching night sweats. There was no history of any facial puffiness or plethora of face as such noted by the patient. There was no history of any recent contact with tuberculosis. Regarding the past history, there was no history of any tuberculosis or any history of surgeries in the past, and he did not have any history of any addictions. There was no history of any malignancy in the family members. Then to the general examination, patient was conscious, coherent, cooperative. He was moderately built, nourished. He had an ECOG performance status of 2. The BMI was 20.5 kg per meter square, and BSA was 1.7 meter square. The pulse rate was 90 per minute. Blood pressure was 126 by 70 millimeters of Hg. The rest of the general examination showed that there was no pallor, icterus, cyanosis, clubbing, pedal edema. There was no facial plethora or puffiness of face noted. There were no dilated veins over the upper part of chest. And we also noted that there was absence of any peripheral lymphadenopathy. Then we went ahead with the respiratory examination. We didn't find any positive findings. Bilateral air entry was heard in both the respiratory fields, and it was a normal vesicular nature of the breath sounds. The rest of the systemic examination was also normal. Patient had a CBC and a sputum AFB done from outside. CBC as displayed is within normal limits. The hemoglobin being 14.6 gram per deciliter. The total count platelet is normal. Even the peripheral smear showed a normocytic normochromic anemia without any presence of any abnormal lymphoid or atypical cells. And there was adequate platelets. The sputum AFB was also negative. Then we went ahead and got the kidney function test and the liver function test. As displayed, both were within normal limit. Also an LDH was done, which showed that there was minor elevation of the LDH. Then because of his respiratory complaints, we went ahead and got a chest X-ray done. The chest X-ray, as you can see, shows a large parahilar paracardiac mass with a broad base towards the mediastinum, indicating that it's a mediastinal mass. We can also see that the ascending aorta seems to be silhouetted with also silhouetting of the cardiac border. So probably it could be an anterior mediastinal mass. So summarizing the case, he was a 25-year-old male who presented with insidious onset and gradually progressing cough with occasional hemoptysis and findings suggesting of an anterior mediastinal mass, probably. So our possible differential diagnosis were lymphoma. The points favoring diagnosis was that his age of presentation between 20 to 30 years, the elevated LDH, what we had noted. But of course, the point against the diagnosis was that there was no peripheral lymphadenopathy noted and there were no B symptoms. The second differential, of course, in this particular age group would be a germ cell tumor, specifically a non-seminomatous germ cell tumor. The points favoring diagnosis would be the age of presentation and absence of any peripheral lymphadenopathy. But the point against diagnosis was that there was no testicular mass on examination. The third differential, of course, would be thymoma. The points favoring was that it was an insidious presentation over a long duration of 6 months. The points against was that thymoma usually occurs between age of 30 to 40 years, and it's associated in 50% of the cases with paraneoplastic syndrome, most common being myasthenia gravis. The other differential that we considered was tuberculosis, fibrosing mediastinitis, hemangioma, myeloid sarcoma. Hence, we've directed our further investigations at ruling out each diagnosis. The next investigations we got was a tumor marker of alpha fetoprotein and beta HCG. As displayed, they were within normal limits. In order to further characterize the mass, the mediastinal mass, we went ahead and got a CCT of the thorax and abdomen. I would request Dr. Tejinder to kindly elucidate regarding the radiological findings.
Thank you, Dr. Lohis. So we went and did CCT scan, and this is a baseline scan from 2017, and these are the axial CCT images. In these images, you can show you can see that there is a homogeneous soft tissue transmission mark, which is present epicentered into the anterior mediastinum, and there is a filling defect which is present in the left brachiocephalic vein extending into the superior vena cava, and it is the encasing the zygous arch as well. And there is a filling defect present within the right atrium, which was also extending into the superior vena cava, and it can be a tumor thrombus as well as a bland thrombus as well. And showing the extent on the coronal section, you can see that it is extending. It is almost touching the apex, and its lowermost extent is still the diaphragm. And there is a filling defect into the left brachiocephalic vein, into the SVC, and into the right atrium. And in these images, we can see that there are multiple deposits, pleural deposits, which are present along the mediastinal pleura and along the diaphragmatic pleura. So differentials on imaging can be a thymic carcinoma, however the age doesn't favor, and there are no areas of calcification or necrosis. Another can be germ cell tumor, but they don't present with metastasis at presentation like that, pleural mets. And third can be a lymphoma, however there was no associated lymphadenopathy in this case. I'll hand back to Dr. Rohit.
Thank you, Dr. Tejinder, for the kind description. So as we can see, we were stuck between both the clinical and radiological differentials falling into the same line. So we went ahead and got a biopsy of that mediastinal mass done. I would request Dr. Janavi, SR from Department of Pathology, to kindly elucidate regarding the pathology.
Good afternoon, everyone. We got a core biopsy. This is a core biopsy from the mediastinum, and we can say it's a fibrocollagenous tissue. And this is the tumor. It's the low power view. This is the hyper view. We can see this is a tumor. In further hyper view, we can see the tumor is composed of oval to polygonal cell. These are the tumor cells with a moderate amount of cytoplasm, vesicular chromatin, inconspicuous nucleoli, and with distinct cell borders. And we can see admixed, these are the lymphocytes with areas of necrosis. This slide showing complete necrosis. So at this point of time, we want to give differential of germ cell tumor since the patient is engaged and mediastinal tumor, and the cells have a moderate amount of cytoplasm, which we generally not see in the lymphoma. So first we want to put a pan germ cell marker, which is a SAL4. This is a SAL4 which came positive. Then we went ahead and put a CD117, which is a marker for the seminoma, which also came positive. So depending upon the histopathology as well as the pan germ cell marker positivity, we gave a diagnosis of seminoma.
Because we obtained the diagnosis of seminoma, the next logical step was to get an ultrasound of the scrotum done. As we can see, the ultrasound of the scrotum was done and it was normal. So hence we arrive at the final diagnosis. The patient was diagnosed to have a mediastinal seminoma with the International Germ Cell Cancer Collaboration Group risk stratification classified as intermediate risk in view of extrapulmonary metastasis. The further course of treatment, the patient was started on VIP-based chemotherapy with effect from January 2017. The drugs included in this particular chemo regimen are etoposide, ifosfamide, cisplatin with growth factor support given every 3 weeks. Patient was also started on anticoagulation in view of major vessel thrombosis as described by the radiologist, and he received 4 cycles of chemotherapy till April 2017. The patient tolerated chemotherapy without any severe toxicities such as chemotherapy-induced nausea, vomiting, myelotoxicity or nephrotoxicity. Then I would again request Dr. Tejinder to kindly describe regarding the post-treatment scan.
Okay, so this is the pre-treatment scan that I have already shown. And on comparison, you can see that this mass has largely disappeared. Only a thin rim of fibrotic tissue with some calcifications can be noted on these axial CCT sections. And on coronal section, this was the mass. And on the post-treatment scan, we can see that the mass is not there and there is some calcific with some thin rim of fibrotic tissue is there. So from radiological point of view, this is a complete response. Also the mediastinal pleura and diaphragmatic pleura, we showed deposits, they have also disappeared. So this is complete response radiologically.
For a medical oncologist, the happiest thing is to see the patient completely cured. The patient is in good health. He had his recent imaging done in January 2021, which showed he was in CR status. He's in regular follow-up. He continues to lead a healthy and active lifestyle. His last follow-up was in March 2021, and he's doing normal. Now, I would request Dr. Aparna to kindly elucidate us regarding the review of mediastinal germs and tumors.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. So we saw in the last few scans a complete resolution of a large mediastinal mass, hence justifying our title for today, Houdini's Act in the Mediastinum. A bit of trivia, Mr. Harry Houdini, a very famous American magician, his forte was his vanishing acts and disappearing acts. This is his famous act that he performed in Boston at the Harvard Bridge in chains. So he disappeared in these chains. So just moving over to the epidemiology. This is the Globocan data of last year, 2020, of all the male malignancies. And we can see out of the 9 million tumors in 2020, only 0.5% tumors were germ cell tumors. Further, out of the germ cell tumors, only 2 to 5% of the patients actually present as extragonadal germ cell tumors. And out of them, half of them, the site is the mediastinum. The other sites include the retroperitoneum, the central nervous system, and less than 5% sacrococcygeal, usually seen in the pediatric population. Out of these mediastinal germ cell tumors, two-thirds constitute the non-seminomatous, whereas one-third constitute the seminomatous germ cell tumors. Talking of mediastinum, we will focus on this part, the anterior mediastinal tumors in males. And so there is the differentials that we entertain are based on the gender, the age of presentation, and also the acuteness of presentation. So in this bar chart, we can see as in the initial 10 to 30 age group, we can see germ cell tumor as well as lymphomas constitute the major chunk of our differential in anterior mediastinal mass. As the age progresses, thymoma becomes the differential of choice. In these differentials also, we can see the seminoma is that light blue area, and they constitute around one third of the total mediastinal germ cell tumor spectrum in the media. So a little bit of history. The first case report of mediastinal seminoma was described way back in 1955. This is a case series which was published in the New England Journal of Medicine. So in the next few slides, I will be taking through a general approach on how to approach a case of primary mediastinal germ cell tumors. Of course, the diagnosis part covered during our case presentation, the role of tumor markers, the imaging, a ultrasound of the scrotum, and the biopsy diagnosis. Tumor markers, more important in the non-seminomatous germ cell tumor. However, even beta-HCG is seen to be raised in around 10 to 20% of the germ cell tumors, and LDH raised in around 40 to 60% of the germ cell tumor. Management constitutes of a multimodality approach. However, our focus today will be on the chemotherapy first approach and how the treatment spectrum has evolved from initially surgery to now chemotherapy first approach. So it is a multimodality treatment constituting chemotherapy, surgery, radiation. Before going over to the management plan, we prognosticate our patients according to the International Germ Cell Cancer Collaborative Group into intermediate, poor, or high risk. So before progressing on the treatment part, just few subtle differences, although the management philosophies remain the same, however, few subtle differences, like non-seminomatous is around two-thirds. Usually the tumor markers are elevated in non-seminomatous, especially the alpha fetoprotein, and the survival. Seminomatous germ cell tumors tend to be fare better in terms of survival compared to the non-seminomatous germ cell tumor. So the risk criteria, we can see good, intermediate, and poor. What we can note is that seminoma does not have a poor risk stratification, only good and intermediate. So the stratification is based on the non-seminoma or seminoma, on the presence of non-pulmonary visceral mets, and of course the serum tumor marker levels. Coming to the management. So once we have assessed the risk, the good risk patient, usually 3 cycles of platinum-based chemotherapy, intermediate risk, 4 cycles. So although we do not have, due to the rarity of this tumor, we do not have randomized controlled trials which can guide our management in mediastinal germ cell tumor. So our treatment philosophies treatment management are extrapolated from all the data that we have for testicular germ cell tumor. Just a small evolution, it is showing the evolution of management in germ cell tumor, that how initially seminomas were reported to be highly sensitive to radiation, and eventually after cisplatin, how multi-agent chemotherapy and cisplatin-based or platinum-based chemotherapy became the standard of care in germ cell tumors. So we have been hearing about BEP, VIP throughout this presentation. Just a short overview. All these are platinum-based regimen. The first regimen is the bleomycin-based regimen, and the second VIP, which we used in our patient too, was etoposide, ifosfamide, and cisplatin. So this is the study which actually showed that there are comparable response rate and survival rates in BEP and VIP. However, VIP, it comes at the cost of a high hematological toxicity, and the bleomycin regimens actually cause more pulmonary toxicity. So in our case, the mediastinal part, usually, although in our patient, there was a Houdini's act, complete resolution, but more often than not, the patients, even after chemotherapy, tend to have some residual disease. So in those cases, if they require a resection or usually radiation or resection, a surgical approach, bleomycin-based therapies have found to have more acute ARDS, prolonged ventilator use. So the pulmonary toxicity is always a concern in the bleomycin-based regimens. So as I said, more often than not, the residual tumors after chemotherapy is where the role of PET-CT has come in the germ cell tumor. So there are multiple studies which have shown that even residual masses, if it is negative on FDG PET-CT, they are usually not associated with viability in the tumor. So now to summarize this whole information, once we have given chemotherapy to the patient, we again reassess the patient. If the residual tumor is more than 3, it is less than 3 centimeter, we can observe. If it is more than 3 centimeter, we can go ahead with an FDG PET-CT scan. If it is negative, again, we can put the patient on observation. However, if there is some avidity, we can either go for a radiation or a resection of the residual tumor. Again, historically, it has been seen that historically, all the residual tumors used to undergo large thoracotomy or resection. But now we have data to suggest that majority of those residual tumor actually have necrosis or fibrosis. So if that is the case, they can still be observed. And if there is more than 10% of viable tumor or an incomplete resection, then the patient has to be considered for a salvage chemotherapy regimen. So, as we have been talking, as the treatment of germ cell, testicular germ cell tumors have evolved, same has been reflected in the case series or case reports that are available for the management of mediastinal germ cell tumor. This is one of the largest and the 50-year experience by a Japanese institution, and out of 50 years, they had only 13 mediastinal, pure seminomal mediastinal germ cell tumors. Even in this series, you can see the initial cases, the earlier cases, we can see almost all of them underwent surgeries like thoracotomies. However, as the evolution of treatment and the multi-agent platinum-based chemotherapy, we saw even in the later part, most of the patients initially first received chemotherapy and then for their residual masses, underwent surgery and radiation. A more recent case series from Canada, this is a 35-year experience. They had 9 mediastinal germ cell tumor and only 1 seminoma in their 35-year experience, and that too with a chemotherapy only, chemotherapy first approach, and the patient is still alive, achieved partial response after a VIP-based regimen. Indian series by Tata Medical Center, Kolkata, 5-year experience. They had 7 pure seminomas, mediastinal germ cell tumor. Also, all the patients received multi-agent cisplatin-based therapy. Our unpublished experience, we 10-year experience, we actually had 30 patients of primary mediastinal germ cell tumors, out of which 22 were non-seminomatous, whereas 8 patients were seminomas. All of our seminomal germ cell tumors are alive, that is 100% survival. Out of the NSGCT, 3-year OSS, 63.5%. Just to elaborate a little on our, so these are those eight patients over the past 10 years. We can see all of them are alive, and most three patients, all of them received platinum-based chemotherapy. Three patients received radiation, and two of those patients had residual resection, out of which the tumor was actually fibrosis or necrosis. So finally, the take-home messages is that whenever we have a young male who presents to us with an anterior mediastinal mass, always the differential of a germ cell tumor should be entertained. It is highly curable. Even tumor markers, a simple investigation, blood investigation like tumor markers can help and actually prevent an invasive approach. And residual tumor, actually, the scalpel can be reserved, and chemotherapy first approach, we can actually only observe the patient and reserve the scalpel. With that, I would like to hand over the dais to Dr. Atul Batra. Thank you.
Thank you, Rohit and Aparna, for the presentation. So with this case, we wanted to highlight that mediastinal germ cell tumors are the entities that should always be kept in mind whenever we have a young male patient who's come to the emergency with a mediastinal mass with either compressive features or even without compressive features. So there are simple investigations that can be done through blood, and a biopsy, invasive biopsy, can be avoided, which includes alpha-fetoprotein, beta-HCG, and LDH. In non-seminomatous tumors, the markers would be raised and a biopsy could be provided. However, in seminoma, more often than not, we would require a biopsy. Seminomas are highly chemosensitive tumors, and the treatment has evolved. If you look at the initial series, they were treated with surgery alone, and they were large thoracotomies. And now they were so platinum sensitive that chemotherapy has now taken the first treatment approach, and then residual tumors were then again resected later on. But now with time, we have also learned that even those residual tumors may not require surgery in all the tumors, and we can observe them. PET is a useful modality in looking at those residual tumors. If that is non-avid, then probably even those large residual tumors can be avoided. The surgery can be avoided. Of the eight patients, two patients underwent surgery. One of them had a large, almost 8 cm residual mass actually. And even that we found fibrosis. Dr. Sunil, I think, have been helping us in the multimodal management and the mediastinal germ cell tumors. And we would love to hear some comment from him as well.
Thanks, Atul. At the outset, one has to realize that actually surgery for each kind of patients comes only when you have a real reason to operate. And many a times we fail to find one. Particularly, whatever our experience has been there, that even if the mass is there, there is, it seems to be a very active kind of mass which is may or may not be PET positive or negative. But 8 cm mass, obviously, if I say that, no, I'm not going to operate, it's probably stands against logic. But this is one of the entities where you have to be very careful. Reason being that post-chemofibrosis is so bad that it's one of the most frustrating surgeries to take care of. Particularly, we don't know where the tumor is ending and where the fibrosis is settling, or what is the post-chemo effect and what is actually residual tumor. And many a times we end up ligating brachiocephalic or maybe reconstructing a number of things. But when the histopath finally comes, you find that there is no residual tumor. And one of the modalities how to sort it out was, and that was initially confusing, essentially was the PET CT. There were two groups for mediastinal, particularly seminoma, and both had conflicting reports. One was from Indiana University, other was Maria De Scientist group from Vienna. But later on, we realized that longer series, they were very much almost to the tune of 95 plus accuracy in terms of taking a call, which all patients might have residual disease. If it's less than 3 cm, certainly it should not be operated, because in all probability, almost 100% of the time, you will be not finding any tumor. More than 3 cm, again, PET negative, we can safely observe. If it's PET positive, we do have a reason to operate. But again, how much sensitivity or how much SUV is changing in terms of pre versus post. That will be a better indicator. But many a times you do not have the preoperative PET CT, so we have to go by just the post-op. I mean, post chemo activity. But again, that's a source of decision-making tool, and that should be the workhorse. Maybe. Maybe you can ask. I mean, elaborate about the radiation role.
Thank you, Dr. Sunil. Again, seminoma is also a radiosensitive tumor, so in those residual tumors where there is activity and more than 3 centimeters, then radiation can also be one of the modalities if it looks like it is surgically inoperable. And with this note, I think I would like to take a comment from Dr. Lalit as well, who's had past experience over the years and guided us in treating these tumors.
We have radiation questions, we can ask. Okay. We should have invited them. Well, I think they have presented very nicely. So medicinal tumors have been of interest to the, I think in general, to all the disciplines. Because like starting from your first year when anatomy dissection hall, given so much of emphasis on the medicinal boundary, this and that. And then when we're in the clinical practice, like looking after small children and they come with the lymphomas, and that's the acute emergency. So when you see some kids with the SVC and you find a chest X-ray by medicinal, the lymphoma is the usual diagnosis or acute leukemia, ALL. Then you grow up in the age, as they said that the germ cell tumor is another in the second and third decade. When you grow a little more in the fourth decade, probably thymoma becomes, one little further higher, lung cancer becomes another. So these are some of the varieties of things which in WC, so you have to really, as a physician, you've seen the particular, like what age groups, what priority the, and sometimes really you can have the metastatic tumors. So don't forget like breast cancer. Occasionally patients can come with the metastasis in the mediastinum causing the various acute symptoms, SVC even. Germ cell tumor from testicular germ cell can metastasize in the mediastinum. That can also be one of the things. So I mean, I think most of the people in the field have seen, and fortunately seminoma is interesting in the sense that they have been very radio sensitive. In our earlier period, we used to give after the diagnosis chemotherapy, and if there is some residual, then we used to give radiation. Surgery occasionally, especially non-seminomatous, and there, like if you have the markers are elevated, then surgery generally becomes very difficult. Then those patients are likely to come back. But we had a few patients who underwent surgery. Initially people thought that would be difficult, but they found the whole everything were like necrosis and few areas of fibrosis. So some cases can be a little easy to operate also. They look like kind of, because of shadow on the CT scan, much bigger. So I think so these patients generally should do very well in the long term.
Thank you, sir.
The lymph node was more than 5 centimeters of raised markers for surgery, but now we are seeing even bigger, there is no residual tumor. So any literature with the PET guided biopsies, or because of the morbidity of surgery is so high, so now we are doing for organ preservation protocols, sometimes we do the histopathology assessment also. Any literature regarding PET guided biopsy for during surveillance?
So for seminoma, actually we have one more modality where radio sensitivity is there, and PET has a role only in seminoma. The problem with doing a biopsy is again the heterogeneity of the tumor, like even if we get a negative report, we can never be sure that okay, this is no viable tumor, that could be tumor is there. Or if we don't get the tumor, again it's a mental situation that things can be lost. But that is always a difficult question. And for non-seminomatous, again, PET is a very poor modality. And again, tumor heterogeneity and somewhere fibrosis, this tumor can be difficult. So, it is one of the most difficult tasks. Even when the testicular cancer tumor with retroperitoneal lymph node is again similar situation.
But in seminoma, like if you have the skin cell uptake, then it has to be taken as a
shot. But if we have
PET positivity,
yes. So PET negative has a very good message, but PET positive is again, you have lots of false positives in the PET, as in all these situations we see. So, but I don't think we have any data on it, you know, because of the reality as such. Still, a point from Dr. Atul Sharma has been, we should also take a message that both the differentials in young patients, lymphoma as well as germinal tumors, both are highly curable. And there should not be any delay in the diagnosis of such tumors. And we have simple modalities to begin with, like a simple CBC clinical smear. If the patient has leukemia, especially if it's a very young age, and tumor samples, this should be offered straight away, and then biopsy can be done after.
The other point, like you see, the long-term outcome is also very good. That is what we have to remember. The quality of life is good. And I think Yuvraj, the cricketer, is one of the best.
Yes. So two of the simple procedure for obesity question from my side. Actually, conventionally we usually use the BP first, then JP, which has been measured. This is our not expected B. But in your case, particularly you use the JP. So what is your take on message? Because particularly this patient or there has been the opportunity to say the literature. So what is your take on message?
There is one
reference from your
trial in primary testicular cancer tumors. That the result was that both the regions are equally effective. The most important reason is that it is planning and the opposite is gone. Then we are placing geomycin by alpha. So the outcomes were similar, the toxicities are different. Geomycin has more of a lung toxicity and the alpha space has more of myelotoxicity. So especially in those of the large tumor masses, we were not sure that there will be a complete disappearance. Sometimes we require a post-op surgery for the disease. And there are data that have shown that there is an increase in incidence of ARDS and most of respiratory infections where BP was. We don't have clear data about only primary prevention, but this is extra different from primary testicles. Both are equally effective, different set of toxicities.
My question is, suppose say recurrence is there when the surgery is not possible, anything reserved for the second?
EIP is another factor, effective in germ cell tumors. So, platinum is the major agent. Then we have other agents which can add on, like paclitaxel is a called EIP regimen. Then we have GEMOX, paclitaxel as further later.